Hi, everybody. Ooh, okay. So we'll probably get started. Welcome to the Slow and the Fast Lane about net neutrality. I'm Ben Crate. I'm from Internet NZ. This is Matthew Jackson from Global Mode, or Bypass, technically. Yeah. So we're the facilitators for today. We're not going to talk for too much, I think. I just wanted to say that we've got a little bit of an idea that we put up on the collaborative note-taking already, so if you guys can do some collaborative note-taking, that would be awesome. Otherwise, we're also going to put things up on post-it notes and do it old school as well. Some things to talk about. I think we just kind of get cracking into it. Matthew?
Hey, so I think one of the reasons I thought we should be discussing network neutrality is that it's kind of boring. Like, as soon as you say network neutrality to somebody that's not on the internet, they go, and they kind of go, they get a little bit sleepy. But the thing about the internet is there's nothing worse than no internet than slow internet. I mean, who hates slow internet, right? Slow internet is the worst thing, right? And internationally, what's happening is we've got laws that have passed in the US, Chile, Brazil, and there's like a pretty big debate that's happening in India at the moment about network neutrality. And what happens, and we do this really well as a group, is that we create these massive policy documents, and they become really difficult to understand for people that the internet is for. And as you see, like our NetHui is about the internet is for everybody. So we kind of put up there the fact that the government's invested $2 billion. It's a public-private partnership to get fast internet to everybody. And we have a potential risk, which is that the telecommunications providers can do paid prioritization of applications. And essentially what that means is that as a business, you're really not going to know whether or not the application that you're using on the internet is going to be slow. So as a business owner, you've put all your cloud apps and you've bought this internet connection, and suddenly you might have to pay a little bit extra just to get prioritization of your Xero app. Or as a small business, you might have put your website up, and if you don't pay the telco some fees, then your website's going to load a lot slower. And as a result, you'll literally lose customers, because we all know that the drop-off rates on a website, you know, if it loads slowly, it's 2 minutes, and 2 seconds, and the customer's gone, or 4 seconds on a mobile. So we have network neutrality at the moment. It's been around for 20 years. The fundamental way the internet operates is that data is passed through the internet as an equal priority, and it's pretty much the last frontier where we have this open access philosophy. It kind of doesn't really exist in the rest of society. So that's why I kind of thought it was an important topic for us to talk about, because we, in the society at the moment, we're not quite sure about the position we should take. Is it important or is it not important? And I think the outcome that we should have from today is, what is the view that as a society we should take?
Just got an initial question, and that is, to a certain extent, we de facto have net neutrality in New Zealand at the moment. Why exactly is that so? There's no law, there's no rules, is ComCom insisting on it? What's actually happening?
Thanks. Connor Roberts from Spark. I guess the best way that I'd explain why it's not happening in New Zealand and it's not as big a debate as it is in the United States is, in the United States, they have most customers are on vertically integrated networks, so that you can't change between WorldCom and AT&T. You are only 70% of the customers are over there can only connect onto the one vertically integrated network. And what that means is they have a lot of control over what you can and can't do as a consumer. So they're selling with the network constraints that are starting to build up because of the Netflix effect over in the US. They're looking at ways at managing their network, and they're managing the data on it. So they've looked at pricing those signals. So in New Zealand, we don't obviously have that. We have Chorus with the underlying network for most of New Zealanders. And on top of it, RSPs that compete. Us RSPs have a whole lot of product disclosure regimes, so if we start to do network neutrality issues, we would have to declare it, and then the Commerce Commission would probably come down on top of us. So I guess our position at Spark is it's not an issue in New Zealand because of the structure that we have in the industry. That's something to consider, obviously, but don't put in place practices straight away because of what's happening in the US is a bad thing that might constrain normal network operations in New Zealand. Thanks.
Colin, did you?
No, I haven't.
All right, so from Internet NZ perspective, so at the moment we have a discussion document out on network neutrality, and it kind of raises a lot of those points that Connor has said, and we've just tried to really, you know, neutrally explore the different issues around network neutrality in New Zealand, and that's kind of my project, which is why I'm facilitating here, because there's a genuine question. Do we actually need to do anything about it as a country? You know, and if so, what? So, you know,
yet?
Yes, yeah. Well, is waiting and doing, I'm a public policy professional, so status quo, waiting and doing nothing is always an option for me. You know, it's just, that's how I'm built. So any other questions or thoughts?
Thank you. I just have a thought on net neutrality. The issue that it's attempting to deal with is one that potentially is very, very important. But it's always struck me as very odd the way that the US, say, is trying to address it, because the issue that net neutrality is trying to address, to me, is very much a one of misuse of market power. And you already have laws about the misuse of market power. Well, I believe you do. I'm from Australia, so I don't really know the situation here. But you've got a Commerce Commission. And irrespective of whether the business is online or in the local high street, you have rules that say, yes, this is normal market behaviour and is acceptable, or no, you've crossed the line and you're misusing your market power. So in my opinion, you know, both for New Zealand and Australia, quite frankly, is you really should be looking at it from a misuse of market power point of view, and using those laws, making sure that those laws are actually able to capture the problem and deal with it effectively. Now, if in using those laws you find the only way you can enact them is by limiting the speeds on the internet, well, so be it. But what I've seen in the US is they've gone immediately from, we're worried about misuse of market power, we have to limit the internet. And I'd have to say I agree with the gentleman from Spark that that's an inappropriate reaction at this stage.
Thanks, Colin. A few years ago, before I retired, I went to two or three sessions of a group, I think it was called IPTV, which is one of these cross-industry groups that was trying to define a standard for in televisions of the future. And it was basically driven from the US. One of the things that horrified me at these meetings was that there were, in many places, there were two parallel sets of facilities in there. One was for private networks and the other was for the internet. And one had all the DRM facilities and the other one was much more restricted. The open one was much more restricted. The private one was the one that had all the real DRM and ID and control facilities. And that was fundamental to the whole project. And it seemed to me, I mean, it was hopeless to argue against it, but it struck me that I hope none of these TVs come down here, because that would build the opposite of net neutrality into the very end user devices that you had.
Just want to offer a slightly different view on the neutrality thing, and yet our friend from Australia kind of picked it up. My experience having worked for several ISPs in New Zealand is that we are driven by two things. Firstly, the want to be seen as pure and objective and not wanting to get in the way of people's packets. So I've seen several ISPs actively use the fact that they're pure bit movers and they don't meddle in things that happen beyond the network layer of connectivity in the interest of remaining neutral. The second thing they have to do is make money. And in the New Zealand market, what I've seen is where people have wanted to meddle with people's packets is because they're doing things like rate limiting BitTorrent, or blocking port 139 because it's a security issue, or blocking outbound port 25 because spam bots abuse it. But as long as their motives remain pure, I think in New Zealand we're at an advantage compared to the scenario in America where you do only have, you know, one or two people to choose from. When I lived in Wellington for a while, I was quite frustrated that wasn't a particularly big fan of what was Telstra Saturn at the time. I had cable to my home, and for whatever reason, I didn't like them enough that I refused to use them. I went and used my copper line and got DSL. I had the choice, but only to that level. I took a lesser grade of service, a heavily asymmetric service with slower speed, because I had the choice. If I wanted to use my cable, I only had one carrier to choose from. No one else is able to get access to that. So I think in New Zealand, we're really lucky that the local loop is unbundled, that we have a regulated player who manages the layer one, layer two, and you can vote with your feet if you don't like the service provider you're with. And I think as long as that remains true, we've got an advantage.
So we have consumers, and there are three main providers that we have, which is Spark and Vodafone and M2. Do consumers understand the difference between speeds and feeds and data? Do they have clarity around policy and really what they're buying when they get their internet connection?
Vaughan Baker, My Republic. Matt, should they need to? Do they care? Why? I mean, I've got a big beef with, Theresa's legacy pervades this marketing by confusion. I'd like to think that My Republic's one of the ISPs that Mark's referring to, in the sense that we don't shape, limit, constrain, deliver an internet connection that people can use for whatever they want. The issue that we have currently, I think, in marketing, and many of the existing sort of incumbents continue to sort of offer inferior products to what we offer at, you know, supposedly sort of better price points, and essentially exploit the fact that the customer doesn't know what they're receiving. So we as ISPs need to be sort of more open and honest with our customer base before we even get into the space of sort of net neutrality.
There's more information about speeds and connectivity than there's ever been in New Zealand's history, so I'm not so sure about that. And prices and price points and plans are, I mean, we have three now, so it's about as simple as it gets. I guess one thing I'd just caution as well against is there are a whole lot of network practices that we do use, and the gentleman over there mentioned a few, that to manage the network so that it performs as best as it could for customers. And I think, to your question, I think that people care about, you mentioned it at the beginning as well, how fast is it, can I connect, and what latency, I mean, what's how fast, you know, slow or whatnot. And so we already use a whole load of network management practices that, if you took a strict definition of net neutrality, every bit is created equal, would fall foul of that. I mean, we cache Google and YouTube and all sorts of content in New Zealand so that we can, A, make the user experience better, so it's closer to the caching nodes, and also reduces the cost, because if it was neutral, we would have to send all the way to New America, get it back down the cable, and provide you the direct stream there. So the cost would be higher and the service would be lower. But if you're looking, I'm Vimo, you know, I don't have as much caching ability in New Zealand and this and that, or whatever it is, that strict definition of network neutrality would rule those kind of things out. And I think the end user experience would be more problematic. And I guess my encouragement would be work back from there. What do the customers want and use when they access the internet? And how do we build a regulatory structure around that that allows the normal type of things that we use to manage the network to be available to us as ISPs and to Chorus and whatnot. And I guess as a provocative thing though, maybe, people have talked about the network, the Netflix effect or the lightbox effect or whatever you want to call it, driving up demand across the network. And we had Chorus here yesterday and Spark on the day before. We were talking about, look, we plan for about 100% growth per year. That's massive, right? I mean, who does that? Well, Chorus saw 40% growth in 3 months. Now, there is a massive, massive wave of data coming down the tubes, and we have to figure out a way of pricing that so that we can build the network to accommodate it so that people can have the end user experience. And why shouldn't we look at options, just to take a very controversial rule, and this isn't Spark policy, to manage the network by way of demand to send that price signal down the tubes so that we can build to accommodate it.
Hi, my name's Keith Davidson, troublemaker at large, and just on the comment on bit rates and so on, I think the confusion technique has lasted well in New Zealand. The concept of having a nominal speed delivered to your home and you're buying that nominal speed or maximum burst speed is absolutely wrong, the wrong way we should be looking at it. And as customers, we should be demanding to know what the minimum speed is, what can we be throttled back to, and we should make our decisions on pricing based around that minimum speed, because when the lines are congested, you want to know whether you've got a usable internet for whatever it is you're choosing, whether it's video or gaming or whatever. So knowing that minimum is a key component, and not many ISPs will honestly tell you that. Thank you.
Hi there, my name's Rillian. Just to the gentleman from Spark, you mentioned that you manage your network as other providers do to the customer demand. Overseas, more than 25% of network traffic is Netflix traffic. Given there's such a large demand for Netflix, why does Spark not have Netflix caches in its network? And the second question is why does Spark not peer?
I'm just going to respond to the gentleman from Spark. Like everybody else, I mean, it's open season, that. But you said, why shouldn't we do whatever practice it is to enable us to generate more investment to build the network? And the answer is because you're in a competitive environment, or there are lots of ISPs chasing the same customer. Spark, in my humble opinion, lives on the fact that it's still basically the incumbent telco and gets a lot of customers that way, and many other people who wouldn't necessarily go to the incumbent telco have a wide range to choose from. And the other thing is that, as others have pointed out, that video on demand, SVOD, is becoming a huge consumer of data across the internet, but very large numbers of people want it, especially the kind of people I venture who are on the default ISP. This is what people are using the internet for to a large extent these days. So just to some extent, I'm really agreeing with the gentleman who said that it's all down to competition, and so long as you have a strong competition regulator and a clear set of policy, you're right. I think Spark will have difficulty increasing its prices to considerably in this space, and it will remain a highly competitive area.
People like Reg Hammond and I have been around spats with people like Telecom over the last 10 or 20 years in the regulatory space, and I've seen people like Connor Roberts come and go and say the sort of stuff that they say now, and you find time and again that there's market abuse taking place as a consequence. This is ultimately all about market failure, about the economics of this. We are a small country. We are absolutely ripe for abuse in the area of net neutrality, by which are widely defined all sorts of things. That includes zero rating, something we've seen already. I don't think for a moment we're not going to have a problem in this area. Additionally, one of the big issues is around the devil's in the detail. So there's different ways you can have models, the fast lane, the slow lanes. That's a good idea, fast lane and slow lanes, on some economic theories. And other ones having exactly the same service is a good economic model as well. But at the end, the devil's in the detail. It's how you play with the detail. And Spark in particular, and I'm using this as an example because of the largest player, is an absolute past master at manipulating the detail to get the right outcome in terms of non-discrimination and differential treatment of customers and users. So I'm prepared to take a bet with anybody that in 2 years' time, if we don't deal with net neutrality, and I suspect we won't, by the way, I don't think for a moment that anything's going to happen, I will take a bet with any player here that we will have significant market failure because of net neutrality issues, widely defined, zero rating, whatever it might be. I'll ask Judge Harvey to be the judge as to whether or not this has happened. A bottle of Moët is the bet. If anyone wants to have a bet with me, see me afterwards. I think my bet's pretty safe. We have an impending problem.
Thank you, Michael. And I'll just say, you know, because this is NetHui and we're all in a safe environment, I think that's enough kicking of Connor. yeah. All right, so free for all. Rich, over there.
I'm Stu from WIC and Drin. At the risk of taking a bet with a lawyer, I'd like clarification on the market failure there. I think there is going to be market failure, but not due to net neutrality. I'll tell you why that is. The emergence of UFB levels the playing field completely. Every small player has the ability to compete with the larger players. The numbers are the same. The margins are the same. The difficulty for the small players is getting enough scale to sustain that. And the market failure will come from the failure of those smaller players who will preserve the original values of the internet, not being able to compete on a level playing field. The level playing field is not due to one larger player abusing the market. It is simply due to the nature of the insane economics that we have for internet in New Zealand. That's the cause of the failure. So I won't take your bet on the bottle of Moët for that happening as a result of net neutrality, but it is coming.
Hi, thanks. Paddy Buckley from QuickFlix. Just a couple of thoughts on all of this. My sense is that there are two sort of main areas of net neutrality that we can be focused on. One is zero rating and the other is paid prioritization. From my perspective, I'm not overly concerned about zero rating. When we launched 3.5 years ago, monthly data caps were something like 5 or 10 gigs a month, and I was talking to any ISP that would talk to me about the idea of zero rating, and even though I'm a believer in net neutrality, I'm also a realist, or sort of was aware of the environment that we were in, and I knew I had to try and do some deals to cut through the fact that there were, you know, data caps were really low. We're not in that place anymore. We're not even nearly in that place. And even I think with with high definition content now, and you know, 4K coming and so on, and you know, just high data consumption, I don't think zero rating is a real issue. I don't think it is. I don't think anyone is not taking up a streaming service because of data issues. So for me, that's not a huge problem. But I think paid prioritization is a problem. I think it's potentially a problem at both ends. It could be that a consumer is asked to pay $5 or $10 a month more to receive or to be able to stream everything properly, and it could be that QuickFlix is approached and told that if they want to be, if we want the experience to be smooth and quick over Spark, then we've got to pay up. So I mean, I'm not suggesting for a minute that is going to happen right now, but I think it is just a potential issue there. So for me, the question is, what if anything do we actually do about it? I mean, legislation seems the sort of the extreme measure. I'm not saying we shouldn't, but it's I don't know that we should be looking to jump there immediately. So the question is, you know, what do we do about the fact that there is a potential risk there?
I really don't want to kick Spark while it's down. In my defence, I work for a medium-sized ISP. I used to work for Spark, so I do get it. But the situation that was just described there is almost already happening in terms of the likes of needing to pay for the privilege of fast data interconnect, and that's thanks to the peering policy. If I want to exchange data with Spark, I have to pay them for the privilege. And if I look at my utilisation graphs on net overall, their eyes are consuming content off my network, and I am paying for the privilege of doing that directly to them because I don't want to ship that data to Los Angeles first. I really think that the big near-term barrier for the issue of net neutrality is around getting free and open peering in our domestic market sorted, because the challenge we have as a company on the end of a rather long set of fibre optic cables is the cost and the economics and the performance of doing things trans-Tasman and doing things across the Pacific. I think we can get our own house in order domestically and save ourselves a lot of drama by being able to take those mega resources and share them in the most efficient ways possible.
Are you guys aware there's like an alternative IX being formed at the moment due to pricing and dissatisfaction on port costs on the IXs?
Yes.
Yeah. I'm just saying. I mean, clearly there's dissatisfaction from a peering perspective because of the fact there's alternative infrastructure being set up. Is anybody on comment on that?
Just because we do have in the room peering.
Yeah, well, we talked about peering, and it's noticeable that the two companies that historically have refused to peer on the same basis as everybody else, both at the time had names starting with T, and both owned the offshore infrastructure, i.e. the in Spark's case only 50% of the cable, but effectively they have a free pipe to San Francisco or wherever. So yes, it's in their interest to push everybody else's prices up by refusing to collect traffic unless it's delivered first to Los Angeles or San Francisco, or charging you for the privilege, of course. And let's be clear about this. They do this because they can.
Well, if they're getting away with that, you really should be talking to your Commerce Commission and bringing them up to speed and getting them to come down like a ton of bricks on the companies that are doing that. But I'm actually going to make a prediction, but I'm not going to put a bottle of Moe on the line because I don't drink. But my prediction is that if New Zealand goes down the net neutrality path and the US has gone down that path, my prediction is that it will fail. It won't, in the medium to long term, actually have the effect of moderating unfair use of market power. And the reason I say this is not because I have some magical insight into what's coming up, but I do have a lot of experience on what has happened in the past. And in the past, we have based our legislation and our implementation of policy on technology. So when the minister did the speech to open the conference, she mentioned convergence. Yes, we based all of our legislation on the fact that to be a broadcaster, you had to have a broadcasting network. To be a telecommunications provider, you had to have a telecommunications network. And as everyone in this room knows, that's no longer the case. The internet can do it all. What we need to get away from is trying to base our legislative tools on technology. But that's exactly what net neutrality is doing. It's saying we have a problem here and we're going to base our solution on technology. So my prediction is, base it on technology, and technology will find a way sooner or later, and probably sooner, to get around it. Which is why I strongly suggest you have a very strong look at your Commerce Commission and your market power abuse laws, because they will be independent of technology.
Can
Can I ask a quick question of the room? How many of you have your internet service provider arrangements at home with either Spark or Vodafone? Show of hands. Okay, how many of you don't? And I'd say that NetHui probably has a greater than average sample of the of net savvy people in attendance. But I think the reason that Spark and Vodafone can do what they do in terms of peering is because they can, because they have that critical number of eyes and they have that market share. And I think we need to convince people that if they want open and neutral access to everything, in part they have to do it by voting with their feet. If they don't like the policies of the company they're connecting with in New Zealand, as was pointed out, we have a choice. You can choose another service provider and get the same services and maybe even get them better. I think for as long as they have the amount of market share, and there were some stats put up at NZNOG this year around the exact amount of market share that Vodafone and Spark have between them. The only way we're going to affect change is with money, because in the end, this is all about business. And I know why they can do it. They've got to deliver a return on investment for their shareholders. And for as long as they can make money by charging for interconnect, that they will do that. And they're obliged as a business to do that because it's making them money. Morally, it might not ring true, but commercially, it certainly is making sense for them. I think that's the change we need to affect.
Hi, everyone. Andrew from Internet NZ, but I'm commenting here as a participant, for want of a better word. And isn't that ultimately, in a way, what saves this entire net neutrality game in general, to your point? The fact is that we have, what, over 80 ISPs in this country now? This is an open question for the room, really. If you don't like the non-discriminatory behaviour that your current ISP is providing, you're likely to be able to find an ISP that will offer you a completely different set of policies that will allow you a very different customer experience. So I'm being a bit devil's advocate here, deliberately, and saying, is that the solution to this net neutrality problem? We're a very open competitive market in New Zealand. Find someone that doesn't discriminate. And if that's got a niche in the market, Vodafone seems to be finding one, then surely that customer proposition will grow. Right now, there are different propositions that are attracting a whole pile of customers too. So is there a problem here?
I'm one of the people with Spark, and I'm with Spark because I don't care enough. Doesn't make any difference to me. Shaping policies, I'm sure they've got them. I've got 100 megabit internet. Works fine, does what I want it to do. If you're talking about consumers voting with their feet because they don't like the policies, for the vast majority of people, they don't see any difference. It doesn't affect them in any way. I want to be able to watch Netflix in bed while the kids are watching streaming video in another room. I don't care about Spark's shaping policies. I don't care about their peering. I don't care about any of those sorts of things. When I get home from work, I want to lie down and watch Netflix. Spark can do that for me, so I've got no particular reason to leave. And so I think that's why they have a very large market share. I mean, we've been through three or four different ISPs that I'm not going to name, and the reasons we left them were mainly due to customer service and lack of responsiveness. Spark's got a fairly bad reputation in a lot of places, but whenever I've had a problem, I've been able to get hold of somebody in less than 2 minutes, and you know, I've got a very technologically unsavvy wife who's also been able to get hold of somebody in less than 2 minutes and explain that you need to turn the router off and on again. You know, my father-in-law, who can't understand email bills, is now with Spark because the ISP that he used to be with changed the pricing on him without bothering to notify him because his 12-month contract was up. Spark works. It does what it needs to do for the average consumer that just doesn't care. And if you are hoping that people will move for the competitiveness, for those sorts of things, you need to make the current and the slightly more longer term issues apparent to Joe average consumer who doesn't care. As long as they can lie down and watch Netflix, you know, what's peering? Where's the information coming from? What time is it? I don't care. I'd lie down and I turn it on and it works. It's as far as I'm interested in.
So, there's a net savvy person really reflecting the public at large, that sort of Adam Smith economic being that makes decisions. The reality is that we're all pretty sticky. We don't know what's going on under the hood. And what you're saying is perfectly understandable and reflects what most of us do, including the people in this room. The reality behind, under the hood, is that because of certain things that are happening, for example, the peering relationships, we may end up paying more because of that, but your average person doesn't realise that's going on, so that's where I guess the regulator stepping is important. To Andrew's point about there being 80 RSPs and there being great competition, that indeed is a good thing, and of course there is much competition, so there is reduced market failure because of that. But I guess what we're talking about here is the prospect that a larger player doesn't, or even a smaller player, possibly even a Sky or whatever, could step in and use market power. And that's the risk, I guess, that we're talking about, and I rather suspect that we do face that risk from a number of players, and I was really only just using Spark because it was the example that was floated at the start. And just in terms of call to action, so if you use the peering example, which is kind of a variation on the net neutrality theme, you know, that's been a problem for us now for, if it is a problem, which I think it is, but held for 20 years. And you know, the regulator could have done something about it. So peering is a telecommunications service. That means any RSP can actually go to the regulator and ask for a regulated service from those that are insisting on peering at reasonable cost-based pricing. You can stop the disproportionate approach to peering. It is possible. So in terms of call to action, peering is sortable via the Commission without politicians being involved. Actually, net neutrality is kind of in the same space too, because it's a telecommunications service and therefore comes under the Telecommunications Act. It's a bit harder because it's more retail rather than wholesale, and the regulations or wholesale. But the reason I've just said all that is to frame up this as a call to action. If you want to do something about peering, go to the regulator and ask for regulation. If you want to do something about net neutrality, think through the pros and cons and the economics of it, and then go to the regulator. You may also have to go to the politicians to get law change. I don't think that is going to happen anytime soon, by the way.
This one's on.
Isn't that? I'm sorry, what you've described is commonly called Stockholm Syndrome and the benefactor model. Your provider is giving you something and you're perfectly happy with it. Step outside that and see the wider picture. That why wouldn't you? Because if you are living in an ecosystem and that ecosystem disappears, then you don't have your benefactor anymore. You're in a privileged position where you are getting what you want from your provider. However, if someone has made a different decision to step outside that, it's not getting what they want because of what your provider is doing. You have a benefactor who is being beneficial, in one sense, to a group and making it harder for another group to prosper and indeed to compete. You mentioned going to the Commerce Commission. It's been done. It didn't go anywhere. Michael says it won't go anywhere either because there is no effective call to action. And again, that is true. Because as operators, our duty to our customers and the wider New Zealand internet is to operate a service. We have to operate. You have to route around the damage which is caused by the lack of a coherent peering policy across all players by finding a way to do that. And the way that people find to do that is to pay the money. If you don't pay Spark, you don't have access to the largest population of internet users which is out there. It has to be done. People find a way to pass that cost on to their customers. Their customers accept that. So there is no revolution coming. There is no mass of consumers carrying pitchforks. It's not going to come from that because of the ethos that we have of continuing to operate a service. But we have to recognize that that peering policy does damage the New Zealand internet. There is no way around that. It's not a coincidence that those bleating about poor Netflix performance are those who do not peer.
So just because we're kind of starting to get towards end of time, I just wanted to think about, you know, so somebody, so Matthew's been scrawling, and we kind of, I guess...
Can't read it.
Yeah. Sorry, internet, I'm in the way. But so, I guess, in terms of summarising or getting there, so, you know, call to action, do we want to do things? Do people want to see something happen? Does there need to be a push? You know, what are people's views? Do we need to? I mean...
I guess kind of why Ben's talking about this is there's been some views, and really what we want to start to shape towards is, do we need to have an outcome from today? And I guess at the moment what we've got is a policy document with Internet New Zealand, and what I'm hearing is that, you know, we've had historical issues with peering, but we know that customers really aren't interested in it. We think there's going to be an issue, and you know, what Stu's kind of raised is that we think there'll be less competition in the future because of the margins associated with traffic, and therefore, and Michael's kind of talked about the fact that there will be, we should expect for this and plan for it. So let's kind of talk now for the next 10 to 15 minutes about, you know, what we've come to as a conclusion, and then what actions we should take as a result.
Sorry for coming in late. Can I just object a bit to the term OTT? I think it's pejorative. I think it's they're saying, oh, they're over the top. You know, over the top. I mean, these are just application services. And we built this network to accommodate application services. So this OTT thing is a pejorative term that a lot of the telcos have introduced in order to try and denigrate what should be just free, the free use of services. And if I might also get on to the net neutrality topic a bit more, you have to condition your networks. I mean, it's important when you're running a network to condition it to make sure that the traffic does flow well and flow appropriately. And we are hitting all sorts of headroom issues around networks. We're using them so much. But I think the policies of the telcos and ISPs need to be open. If they're going to impose fast lanes, slow lanes, whatever, or quads, then they need to be open and transparent about it, and so that their customers can choose. And it needs to be a reasonable choice, to not just pushed into, you know, a crappy best effort service. It needs to, if you can buy stuff with QoS, it should be an open and transparent thing that customers know about.
Keith Davidson, three small points, I think. One is that peering is probably of no advantage to someone who wants to only ever look at Netflix or something like that. But we live in a country that's quite often faced with emergencies like earthquakes and so on, and perhaps one day when Rangitoto blows its top and you have a volcano in Auckland and so on, then the benefit of peering will become immediately obvious because you've got several alternate paths to get data around the country. So never forget the robustness of the network is dependent on multiple paths, and therefore ISPs that do not peer should maybe be considered to be not so useful to you in periods of emergency and so on. And certainly this is becoming apparent through the Pacific Islands with their problems with tsunamis and you know, cyclones and so on. So always consider that the internet is more about your total communications, not just about Netflix and streaming video. I think the other thing is, I don't want to see all ISPs the same. So net neutrality saying everybody will deliver me a bitrate that's like this means that I can't discern that I want to use this ISP for gaming or this ISP for streaming video and so on. So I want to see differences in ISP services. What I do want from net neutrality is that an ISP cannot set up an exclusive arrangement with a provider of a service like Netflix. So ISPA saying we have an exclusive arrangement and you have to belong to this ISP in order to get that service. I think net neutrality to me means that there is no restriction on my access to various content through because I decide to have an ISP, that I still have the right to reach the entire internet. Thank you.
Thanks. I'll just pick up on the OTT thing for a moment. I mean, you're right, OTT is a piece of framing, but let's just unpack why it's being framed that way. OTT refers to essentially voice calling and text services, which telcos used to be able to charge for, and used to be able to charge more for than they can charge for straight out routing IP. So many people in this room are effectively arguing that their telco should just provide them with IP and nothing else and just shut up and get on with it. And all we're really doing is arguing about how much IP and how fast it should be. And that's kind of nirvana from some people's perspectives. Whether money can be made in that is another matter, and I think certainly the incumbent telcos find that a fairly horrific prospect. Some of the more modern players, perhaps. Mobile providers, for instance, always used to and may still have T's and C's that effectively say you can't run VoIP across this, and we reserve the right to try to prevent you. I paraphrase a 70-page document, but I think that's probably still there. It may be in the Spark Mobile. I'm pretty sure it's in Voda Mobile. So, and there was a situation 10 years ago when, and I'll choose my words carefully for the not wishing to be actionable, but it was rumoured strongly that the incumbent telco was forcing Skype calls to drop out after a few seconds. So this kind of thing's been going on for a while. But really, the conversation to me seems to be about, is there a viable market in companies that simply exist to route IP to and from in retail customers?
It's I actually don't have an answer to your question. I was more sort of picking up on what Keith said about content. You know, so I think there's a big piece in here around the rights to content and users and consumers being able to access content. In Singapore, where we originated, slightly different regulatory environment, but they passed some must-carry legislation because they found it very inefficient that every time the English Premier League rights shifted from one telco to another, everybody shifted provider. So the powers that be actually thought, well, that's actually a bit silly, let's pass some must-carry legislation. So it dropped the price for the rights for the EPL into Singapore almost overnight. So picking up on Paddy's point too, we've never sold a capped plan. We don't believe it's right to ration the internet. We don't think there's a need to. So it's more around the service that you're delivering. So if you're delivering a streaming service that works, a gaming service that works, and as long as people's access to content is preserved, wherever that may be from, we're going a long way towards actually maintaining or preserving the experience that the gentleman over here, the satisfied Spark customer, is currently experiencing. As he grows his family, as he moves to the Internet of Things and everything's connected, he's going to find that he's going to need to sort of upgrade his plan. I think the commercial competitive aspects are in place. As long as we can actually access the content we want, what we want, when we want, from wherever.
Hi, my name's Daniel. I work in libraries. One of the things I was thinking about is perhaps an analogy is to use roads also as another piece of infrastructure. One of the lady over there was talking about, like, as long as I don't mind paying more if I can get, say, 20 milliseconds latency or a certain guaranteed minimum speed at any time, as long as I know that that choice is there, I don't mind actually paying extra for it. And I think one of the other benefits of that is if there are people who are willing to pay more, just like with roads, like the Auckland Harbour Bridge, if they never had tolls on that, would we have ever built it? After a period of time, the people who've paid more ends up, the infrastructure's funded, and then it becomes free. And maybe that might be the case here, because we are obviously not funding our network fully, because Chorus, people can debate this, whether it's right or wrong, had to go to the government to get money for upgrades to fibre. And that's the other side of this argument, is that we've got net neutrality, but if people can't make money off the network, what happens to that network over time? And it looks like with things like Netflix, we're obviously going to have to keep on upgrading, and that's going to have to come from somewhere. So I just wanted to throw that in there.
One of the things we were supposed to be talking about in a summary is, do we need to do anything? And that's really what my comments were about, is there's a lot of talk about how competitiveness will solve the problem. If you don't like it, vote with your feet. And it's just not going to happen. Until or unless there are major problems with getting your service through Spark, nobody's going to move. You know, I'm reasonably IT savvy. I'm at least aware of the fact that there's a peering problem. I don't care. It works. I get reasonable customer service. I get the service that I want. So I'm not going to move. People who don't even know what it means are certainly not going to move. It's going to work for them, so they're going to continue using it. And you can call it Stockholm Syndrome. You can say that it's a bad thing, and quite possibly is. But the question of, do we need to do anything, is yes, because thinking that people will leave because there's a problem and go to other companies, vote with their feet, find somebody who's got better policies. No, they won't. They'll turn it on. It'll work. End of conversation for probably 80, 90% of the users of internet is, I turn it on and it works. I'm done.
Yeah, and personal experience on that, my wife has to pause her Dropbox. She runs a business. She uploads massive files. And if I want to play on my Xbox, I have to go and say, can you just pause that so I can actually not get lag killed? I should go off ADSL. I have fiber on my road. It's been on my list for 4 months to do. I just, you know, it's, yeah. No, so like, you know, but that is that, like, it's on the list. I'm totally going to do it tomorrow. You know, so there, you know, you can't underestimate that. You know, I route around it by just asking my wife to not do things that kill my.
I heard the comment before that you've tried talking to the Commerce Commission and they didn't do anything useful. It really shouldn't be a surprise. I spent many years working at Telstra and other telcos in Australia, and more recently I spent 4 years working in the regulator. And let's just say that the people that work at the regulator are self-selected for not being particularly strategically minded, because I certainly found it very frustrating to survive in that environment. But that's not to say that the regulator is not extremely important. Rather than giving up on the regulator, my suggestion is that an organisation like this one really should be taking on the challenge of ensuring that your regulatory structures are actually able to cope with the internet. Because like the rest of the world, New Zealand's regulatory structures and Australia's regulatory structures don't cope well with the internet. The politicians are only going to react if there's sufficient popularity in it. And certainly the people in the regulatory authorities are probably only going to react if the politicians tell them to. We've already noted that the people in this room are representative of the most net savvy parts of the population of New Zealand. And so really it's your responsibility and our responsibility in Australia to educate our politicians and get them to kick the regulators into appropriate action and educate them as to what are appropriate market rules for the internet, because the rules they currently have were invented for the pre-internet, and it's not surprising that they don't work.
Hi. I'm from America, where we have really horrible internet because of a monopolistic behavior of the internet service providers there. It's a very monopolistic situation. And I thought, hey, here in New Zealand, we've got a really great setup in the sense that we've got common infrastructure that all ISPs have access to, and that we've got this really nice competition thing going. And I have to say that what I'm hearing now is that ISPs don't have equal access to that common infrastructure. And I have to find that quite disillusioning. All right, I think that's a fundamental problem here. I like the road analogy, and it's like, hey, we don't have a lot of private roads here in New Zealand. Why is that? It's because the roads serve a really important common good. And internet access here is not just a matter of being able to watch Netflix. It's really fundamental economic security for the country. And if we can't get it right, it's going to hurt everybody. And so I see this as just a huge, important issue. And I'm just gobsmacked that it turns out that our core common infrastructure is being monopolized by a few.
So everybody, I had two jobs to do in this room. One of them was to wear this fetching orange number, and the other one was to keep you informed about time. I've succeeded in the first and failed in the second. So this is your NetHui bird monkey noise now. Rah, rah, rah. Because we're out of time, but I was going to suggest that if anybody has a burning final point that they'd like to make, I think that this is your speak now or forever hold your peace moment. Two burning points.
So net neutrality, as has been put, sorry, this is Narelle Clark, I'm with the Internet Society at Times, and I just wanted to point out the principles of the five alls that comes from that Alejandro Pisanti put out. Fabulous Mexican guy that works in a lot of our chapters, and now I can't find it. It's all protocols, all ports, all destinations. I've lost it now. It's gone into another screen. I'll tweet it out. But it's the five alls, all ports, all protocols, in a non-discriminatory fashion.
Hi, I'm Mark from the Netherlands originally. I would like to have net neutrality in the law, because at the end, if there's no net neutrality, then it will kill creativity for content providers, etc. So that's my point.
Oh, yeah, outcome of policy, that's so not a thing. All right, so thank you everybody for coming along. I guess from my perspective, if you have burning issues and desires or points of view that you want to get down, we are currently collating people's thoughts and trying to do a nice collaborative internet community. So I think it's the URL is in the collaborative notes, but you can find it at internetnz.nz/net neutrality or network neutrality. It's on our site. We've got a discussion document and a survey to make it easy for people. And if anyone has any ideas or things they want to talk to us, either head up Matt or me afterwards. And I think for people who are together, you're running a thing tomorrow?
Yeah, tomorrow morning.
We're just discussing some stuff at Gather tomorrow morning around net neutrality. I don't think there'll be much crossover from this group, but by all means, come along to that and we can continue the discussion there.
Thank you.